Welcome to Holy Cross. I'm Pastor Adam. So good to be with you today. Pastor Brian continues to recover, but preaching and sharing the Word of God with us today is Pastor Larson, previously a pastor here at Holy Cross, now continuing to serve in a variety of capacities, including home visits and things. And we're so thankful that he could bring the Word of God to us today here as well. Man, as we get together, I want to give you an update. We welcomed you into this opportunity to gather school supplies for local students. There were 71 backpacks of school supplies requested, and I want you to know that not only were 71 cards picked up, but 71 backpacks have now been delivered back to Holy Cross so that we can send them out to those schools and be picked up by those students so that they have all that they need for the school year ahead. Thank you for leaning in. I am honored to be able to be a part of a team that loves and cares in these ways. So thank you for your participation in that. We're excited for that. So these backpacks, they help families that for whom there are financial struggles, and the supplies is one way to help. But we also know that food is the first thing that flexes when finances are in a tough place. And we also have a ministry that helps attend to those things. It's called Hand to Hand. It's for students that are at risk of going hungry over the weekend. And in 30 minutes, you could help 130 of those kids make sure that they have food over the weekend. It starts in September, commitments like once a month, sometimes a little less than that. If you could do that, we would love for you to partner with us in hand-to-hand ministry. More information on that in the Friday emails. The next thing is August 30th, 2 weeks away, Sunday. There's two opportunities. One, for families that have kids up through fifth grade. It's a family connect. Starts at 1 p.m. Details in that email as well. And the second one on August 30th as well is for everyone. It's our Sent Out Sunday, and it's at 10 a.m. And I know I dropped the teaser last week and didn't really tell you what it is, and I will get there this time. You're wondering, what am I going to put on my calendar if I don't know what it is? We'll get there. But first, and I think it's more important that you understand why it's worth putting on your calendar. Simply, it's this. We are sent. And we struggle to embrace this individually and on our own. So we're going to work at getting better at it together. This event will not only remind you of our sentness, but it will also equip you for going and help you embody the sentness of Jesus more fully, not only on that day, but in your daily life. For this Sent Out Sunday, we'll accomplish this by sending you out to pray for our local neighbors. Here's what it will look like for all of you that have been wondering. August 30th, 10 a.m., we'll gather in our back parking lot. You will receive a word of encouragement and directions for using the prayer guide that we're going to provide to you. And then we'll be sent out into the neighborhoods immediately surrounding Holy Cross. There you'll use that prayer guide that we've given to you and taught you how to use. And after that, you get to return to Holy Cross for a time of fellowship. And when that's complete from you, you get to head out to the places to which you're also sent. But you'll go as one that's not only more focused on Jesus' mission, but also as one that's more confident and prepared to embody it by offering the same kinds of prayers for your neighbors. Finally, I want you to know that we've continued to consider your comfort and your safety as we plan this. This is a safe, socially distanced kind of event. You're not knocking on doors, or expected to pray with others. We'll just be using prayer as a way to bless our neighbors. In fact, you could do it all from the comfort and safety of your own car with the windows up and the AC on. It's just 2 weeks away. I hope you'll join us for our first Sent Out Sunday, where we'll get better at being sent by going together. But you've joined us here today for worship, that we can turn our hearts to our Heavenly Father, we can receive His blessings, be filled up again. So in order that we might focus on that, let's turn our hearts to prayer. Oh, most powerful and merciful God, thank you for being with us. We pray today that you would protect us from all harm and danger. Make us ready, both in body and soul, to cheerfully accomplish what you want done through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. We agree and we say together, amen. Let's sing.
Sing for joy, let us praise and shout aloud to the lifter of our heads, to the rock we're standing on. Your salvation is our song, now we can't stay silent, we will sing out. Great is your love for us, and great are the things you've done, and praise is the offering we bring to you. Lord, we come to worship you. Lord, we bow our hearts in awe. By your love we are redeemed. Are yours and your own God. Your salvation is our song. Now we can stay silent. We will sing how great is your love for us, and great are the things you've done, and praise is the offering we bring to you. All of our heart and soul and offering we bring to bow our hearts in awe. By your love we are redeemed. We are yours and you're our God. We are yours and you're our God. We are yours and you're our God. Great is your love for us, and great are the things you've done, and is the offering we bring to you. All of our heart and soul and all that you are and more and praise is the offering we bring to you.
Praise is the offering that we give. Father, it is with joy that we do have the opportunity to praise you yet again for all that you are, for all that you've done through Jesus, and by sending of your Spirit to empower and to continue Jesus' work in us and through us. Lord, we so don't deserve it. Would you pray with me? But Father, we pray today that your actions, your love, and your word would be what we hear and see most clearly. But we have to confess that so often we notice everything but them. Lord, we look at our standing in the eyes of our family members or our coworkers. We look at our accomplishments. We look at our financial position. We look at our failures. We look at our fears. And with our minds, on them, they often become how we define ourselves. They set our identity, not your word and not you and your name on us that sets our identity, but these things. And out of that flawed identity flow our actions. We end up not prioritizing our responsibility, our calling to represent you to the world. Father, for the times when we've ignored your leading, when we've complained about your providing, when people have missed the chance to hear about and experience your love because of our failures, Father, we pray that you forgive us for these errors, for these wrong inclinations, and for all the sins that burden our consciences today. Forgive us. Friends, lift your eyes and know that this truth is real for you today. Our God, the Almighty God, is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and he has claimed you as his own. He has called you son or daughter and told you, I am your loving God. And through Jesus, you are forgiven and set free to delight in his will and walk in his ways. Know that this is true because your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Lord, help us walk your servant way wherever love may lead, and bending low, forgetting self, each serve the other's need. You came to earth, O Christ, as Lord, but power you laid aside. You lived your years in servanthood, in loneliness you died. No golden scepter, but a towel your place within the hands of those who seek to follow you and live by your commands. You bid us bend our human pride, nor count ourselves above. The lowest place, the meanest task that waits the gift of love. Lord, help us walk your servant way wherever love may lead. And bending low, forgetting self, each serve the other's need.
The scripture for our focus today is from Exodus, chapters 3 and 20. Now, Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight. Why the bush does not burn up? When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, he called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here I am. Do not come any closer. God said, take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. And then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of the land that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now, go, I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you. And this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. Moses said to God, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. And they ask me, what is his name? Then what shall I tell them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. And from Exodus 20, and God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. The words of our God.
We interrupt this program for an important tech update. This is Hugh Ought to Know with today's Eyewitness News Tech Update. A new communications platform was introduced today by none other than serial entrepreneur and renowned explorer Moses. You may recall Moses' special effects and pyrotechnics on Mount Sinai a couple of days ago when there appeared to be a burning bush, but it was not consumed by the fire. While the technology behind this was not revealed, Moses thanked God for the sign. Pretty cool stuff. Moses grew up in Egypt, where he was adopted by Pharaoh's own daughter after being found floating alone down the Nile River. Placed in positions of responsibility with Pharaoh, Moses learned many things in Egypt before eventually leaving in the most unique manner by walking through the parted Red Sea. The engineering or technology Moses used was never revealed, although Moses thanked God for the help. Moses' latest introduction was a unique communication app. The new app uses stone tablets to deliver a message to large amounts of people. The stones have a limit of 5 statements per tablet, which doesn't sound like much, but Moses showed an example of 2 tablets that said everything that needed to be said. Note that the example is in Hebrew, but the message is for all languages. It will be interesting to see if this invention gains adoption with young and old alike and how many downloads it will get. This is Hugh Ought to Know with the latest in your tech news. Keep those thumbs working. Good day.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from him who was, who is, and who is to come. So we continue our series on the biblical stories that maybe somewhere in your life you've heard. Maybe it was in Sunday school and they were just stories. And we want to continue our exploration of those stories that we know well to see an even deeper meaning that God is communicating to us. So today, we take a look at that guy named Moses, and I'm immediately in trouble because right away, all of you that at least saw the movie are thinking of Charlton Heston, and you're looking at me and saying, that guy didn't look anything like Charlton Heston. But my consolation is I don't think Moses did either. So if we can scratch Charlton Heston from our minds for the moment, let's think about Moses. And we're going to look at 2 episodes from the life of this great leader of the children of Israel. The first, they both come from the book of Exodus. The first of those is the call of Moses through a rather unusual event, and that is a burning bush that burns but isn't consumed. And then secondly, when God gives to the children of Israel through Moses the 10 commandments and his law for them as a nation. So let's take a look at that first episode where Moses is out in a wilderness. He sees a bush burning and it isn't consumed. But for a moment, a little background on Moses, and I'll do it quickly. So this is the guy that when he was a baby, the Hebrew baby, is placed in the little boat by his mom because they're killing Hebrew boys. And it floats down the river. He's found and adopted by Pharaoh's daughter, so raised with all the benefits of being in the royal house. And then as an adult, he begins to discover that he's not an Egyptian. He's a Hebrew. And the Hebrews are the slaves. One day he sees a Hebrew being beaten by his master, an Egyptian. It infuriates this Moses. He goes out, he kills the Egyptian, which causes the Egyptians to turn against him, and now he has to flee. He's out in the wilderness, and he's now just a shepherd. And that's where we pick him up, in the wilderness, looking at not just sheep, but a bush that burns and isn't consumed. Of course, that causes him to wonder what it is. He wanders over to it. A voice comes out of it, and the voice calls his name, Moses, Moses. And the voice continues, and it says, I'm the God, Moses, the God of your ancestors, of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. And I have chosen you, shepherd boy, to lead my people out of the slavery in Egypt to a land of their own. So go back there. Immediately Moses reacts, as all of us would, with a nervousness and an inquiry. He's not sure that Hebrews will accept him. Last they saw, he was getting out of Dodge. He's not sure the Egyptians won't once again seek his life. So he says to God, if I go back there, whom shall I say sent me? He looks for an identity he sees he doesn't have in order to convince not only the Egyptians, but even his people, the Hebrews. And at that moment, God does something for the very first time in the Bible, and it is one of the most important sections in all of Scripture, certainly in the Old Testament. God says, you want to know what to tell the people who sent you. Moses, you tell them not that God sent you. There are a lot of gods out there. I'm going to tell you something that neither you nor they know. I'm going to tell you and them my name. My name. Moses, you tell them, I am sent you. It's a form of the old Hebrew infinity, the to be word. It means I am or I cause to be. It's an ancient form of that verb. You tell them, Moses, I am, not a God, I am. And with that, God gives to Israel, and not just to Moses, an identity that they are the God of I am. Somewhere around the 1100s in Europe, it was the custom to just have one name. We would say your first name, your personal name, for example, Johannes or Catherine or whatever name. And then around the 1100s, there were a lot of Johanneses and there were a lot of Catherines. So somebody said, you know, we need to identify people a little more than just Johann. So let's add to Johann or Catherine some personal identity. So maybe Johann was short, so we'll call him Johann Small. Or maybe Catherine's father was a smith, so we'll call her Catherine Smith. Or maybe Johann was the son of Peter, so we'll call him Johann Peterson, and so on. So to that first name is added now more an identity. When God gives to Moses and to Israel the name I Am, he gives an identity. He gives to them the identity of who he is, and only they will know it. And with that, he gives them the identity of my people, my leader. I exist, and I cause all of existence to be. Where did you get your identity? Well, when you were born, your mom and dad gave you that at least first name. When you were baptized, we would say, as Christians, You gained another identity. Did you ever notice in the very simple act of baptism, which is just an application of water, that names are involved? The pastor would say your name, in my case, Peter. And then he would add to that, I baptize you, Peter, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And now Peter has another identity, child of God. And then our Lord Jesus Christ comes into the world and says, but that identity given you in your baptism, you've broken, Peter, many, many times. So I will restore that identity. And on the cross, he gains forgiveness. He gains the promise of his presence and the promise of the eternal day. And my identity, once given, once broken, is now restored. Don't ever let anybody take your identity away. Don't ever give it up. Don't ever let anybody demean you to the point that you are less than a chosen child of God. Don't ever let your failures, your confusion, your sins say, I've broken that relationship, I have none anymore. Because in Jesus Christ, that relationship has been restored. Don't ever let anyone take your identity as a child of God away, and don't ever give it away. Because God will surely never recall it. And he has given us, the scriptures say, his Holy Spirit, the gift of faith, the gift of his presence, the gift of the new life, as a sign that he preserves that identity. Don't ever lose it. He calls your name as his child. It will forever be your name. So then we turn our attention to the second event from the life of Moses. So Moses goes to Egypt, you know perhaps the story, the plagues, and Pharaoh finally says, get out of Dodge, take these people and go, and he does. And they're led into the wilderness of the Sinai Peninsula. And then, and here's my risk again with the Charlton Heston thing, he goes up on a mountain and God gives to him the commandments by which Israel will define themselves as a nation, by which they will have their morality, by which they will have their religious events. And that event is God adding something to identity. It is God saying to Israel, you are my people. I have chosen you. I have given you my name. But now I send you into the world to show the people of the world who you are, but more importantly, who I am. He calls you and me to be Christ in the world. Jesus said it this way. He said that you are like the light of the world. You're like a light that shines into darkness, that can bring to the darkness only what it can bring, an illumination of all that is there, of all that can be seen. It goes without much question that the world in which you and I live is indeed a world of darkness, a world of people pitted against each other, a world of people tearing down instead of building up one another, a world of exclusiveness, a world of grabbing for what does not feed, a world in which we divide one another on mostly silly reasons, not only from God, but from each other. And now God invades that world in Jesus Christ. And Jesus says, I, through you, am the light of the world. He wants us and the world to know, not simply what he, God, is like. He wants us to know what the world can look like, what the world can be. He wants us to know that love does not, that love given in him through Jesus Christ is the love that we can bring to the world. He wants the world to know that God does care about its brokenness, and he sends us as healers. He wants the world to know that God does care when his people hunger, and he sends us to feed. He wants the world to know that God does listen to prayer, and he sends us to listen to the hurts and brokenness. He wants the world to know that God cares about all his people, and he teaches us to care about all people, to discriminate against no person, because all people are called in his name. Jesus doesn't look like the world, and God's people can't look like the world, my brother and sister. You and I have been given an identity as children of God, heirs of eternal life. We are God's light in this world. We are to take our identity, God's identity, and share it to the world. I heard, I think it was maybe a week and a half or so ago on the news, that when parents in the nation of Hungary give birth to a child, they can name that child anything they want as long as it's within the list of approved names. Why would the government want to approve names? I don't know that rationale. But I do know this, that if it isn't on their list, it better be on their list, because every child born in Hungary and every other nation bears the name Child of God through Jesus Christ. You bear it. I bear it. Let us live it. Let us live it so that not our names are defined, but the name of the great God, I Am, is defined through Jesus Christ. May God bless you. May you be a light that shines in the world so that the world may see not you or me, but the God who has called us now and until the eternal day. God bless you. Amen.
We indeed have a God that has not only told us His name, but put His name on us. And what a privilege that is. Let's take joy in that by speaking together about who this God is for us. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We'll use the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I shared at the beginning of the service that all of the backpacks have been returned to us so that we can pass them on to the schools, but I think it's even more impactful if you get to see it. Check it out. 5 cartfuls of them. I want to invite you into a time of prayer for those that will use these backpacks and the schools that will be blessed by them. These backpacks, as you think about them, are going to be the thing that gets carried back and forth to and from the school by children here in our local community. These backpacks will contain work that needs to be done, work that's been returned, books that need to be studied, tools that will be needed to complete the homework, stuff that we've helped to provide, that some of you have helped to provide, notebooks, pencils, markers, glue, even those that are sewing things have put two homemade cloth masks into each one of these backpacks. What a joy it is to be able to gather our resources together to be a blessing to others. This is part of what the church is all about. I want you to picture for a sec where these backpacks are all going to go. Some days as they're carried on backs, there's going to be so much stuff in them that it'll be difficult to walk. Other days they'll be light and nearly empty. But on each and every one of these days, these backpacks represent work required of the students that are in our local community. And as in every aspect of our life, we bring before our God these things and ask Him to bless them. I invite you to do that with me today. Eternal God, Jesus Christ, You were once a little child Yourself, learning and teaching in the temple. And Father, we pray that all who are learning, all who enter places of learning, whether with these backpacks or others, Lord, that they would be filled by Your grace and Your wisdom, and that Your Spirit would direct them over the course of the year. Furthermore, particularly, we ask Your blessing on the students who will wear these backpacks. Help them, help the things within them to help them grow in knowledge. And as they've received this blessing, enable them to strive to be a blessing to others. As they receive these supplies that they didn't earn or deserve, we pray, Lord, that You would continue to move their hearts toward embracing Your love that none of us can earn or deserve. And Lord, as I think about these backpacks, I also think about to all the other students and the administrators and the teachers and the decision makers at the beginning of this year, with all the additional uncertainty and stress that it brings, both for families and for those that are working in the schools and the colleges. So, Lord, we pray to you, who promised to guide us through the wilderness and to protect us through the storm. We ask that you would make us wise where we cannot clearly see the way forward. Make us brave when we feel afraid. Make us strong in the face of our weakness. Make possible what seems impossible, so that we might joyfully entrust ourselves and the children of our communities, and in some cases our homes, into your tender care in these trying and troubling times. In Jesus' name we pray, and we agree, and we say together, amen. Now continue to join me in the rest of our prayers for today. Great God and Creator, in your wisdom you breathe the breath of life into us, into bodies that fail and falter on this side of eternity. And you also give us souls that endure forever. So Lord, we pray, help us use and care for our bodies well, so that they can be a tool for your leading, for leading us to eternity. Bring healing to those who need it, who we name now. Give hope to those whose loved ones' souls have already been carried to be with you for eternity, whose bodies now wait the resurrection on that last day. Father, you sent your Son into the world not to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. We know that you care about every sheep under your care, and that you know the troubles that come their way as they put their faith in you. So, Father, we pray that you give your protection to those who are under attack because of their trust in you. Be their good shepherd. Protect their life. Help their faith to grow as they see you provide. And finally, Jesus, you who are the light of the world, you who made us to be the salt of the earth, to season every person along our paths with the good news of your resurrection and victory over death and the power of the devil, we pray that you would help every missionary to cling to this hope and never relent. Give them endurance, perseverance, and a glimpse of how you are pushing back the darkness by your word and their testimony. We ask this for every Christian missionary, and especially for Nora and Leon as they continue to do your work in Haiti. Father, we entrust all these things to your care, as well as the other things that are on our heart, and we gather them all together using the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Singing, oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. All souls atoned by the blood of the Lamb. I'm not a slave to what once held me damned. How beautiful that cleansing flood. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. We're singing, oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. sincere, I'm not ashamed of what once shackled me. How infinite that grace divine. I am free, I am free, I am a child of God. We're singing, oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. In the blood of Jesus, how priceless, how precious. There is power in the blood of Jesus. How priceless, how precious. There is power in the blood of Jesus. How priceless, how precious. There is power in the blood of Jesus. Power, power. Wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. My Lord, now I'm raised to life forevermore. My name's been carved upon your heart. No, not death, no, not hell could ever rip us apart. We're singing, oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched. Precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love.
What a beautiful image. I am washed, I am drenched in love. The love of a God who says, my name is on you. I am for you. This is who you are. And let me lead you into the fullest life that you could give, a life of following me, representing me to the world. We have this great opportunity. It is yours to lean into this identity of the God who says, I am, and says, you are mine. We pray that that picture of being drenched in this kind of love would carry you through the week ahead. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Friends, as you go into the week ahead, I encourage you to use those discussion questions. I thank you again for your prayers on behalf of Pastor Brian. He is progressing well as you can. So thanks for keeping those up, and know that he'll be back as soon as he reasonably can. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.